Hello from Johannesburg. This is Lisa John from the Civicus Alliance. It's a huge privilege to be contributing to the Feminist Leadership Series. Thank you for inviting me to do so. So the first question I'm going to answer is what feminist leadership means to me. Essentially, I would say that it involves challenging the kind of deep-rooted notions of singular leadership that we often grow up with. So as children, we listen to stories about these exceptional leaders or people who rescue communities or their countries from crisis. In modern day management literature, we continue to hear about these singular heroes who lift their organizations out of oblivion and fast track them towards success. I think feminist leadership really involves putting the lid on that. It involves reinforcing and reclaiming collective leadership and making that the norm rather than the exception in our organizations. So in order to activate that form of leadership and really cultivate collective leadership, I think the two prerequisites that we need to have at both individual and institutional levels are the ability to recognize the power of interdependence. So really acknowledging that the solutions to the big and complex challenges that we're dealing with in the world today require many, many, many more organizations to come together and think through how we do things differently. It also requires a very high level of humility, the ability to say that I don't know everything, and therefore I need other people to bring what they know to in order to make what I know more important and relevant. So I think essentially when I look at what organizations need to do in order to enhance and nurture this entire enabling environment for feminist leadership, I would say it involves a very, very strong emphasis on solidarity. So the principle of collaboration rather than competition is something we need more of within our organizations and across them. I think it also involves a high degree of being vulnerable and being honest with yourself. So our ability to sit down and interrogate how we make decisions and what decisions we make and what are the underlying assumptions behind those choices. So very often I think our measures of success are derived quite directly from, again, the models that we grow up with or the frameworks that we grow up with, which include an emphasis on capitalism or the privilege that we accord to certain sectors or communities as a result of colonialism or patriarchy. And I think it really means being willing to place a value on learning above the value that we have on kind of prevalent outcomes that are linked to being resource rich or having or exercising control over others. So I think being able to have those conversations in a very honest but also constructive way is what determines and defines feminist leadership. At a wider level, within the sector, I think the calls that we're seeing for resourcing reforms, for the redistribution of resources to local organizations in the global south are a good example of how this plays out. And I think ultimately it's again about reinforcing the dynamic of mutual learning, of collaboration, of co-creation over the dynamic of competition and control. So to end, I'm going to speak about two examples I've been inspired by and closer to in relation to how feminist leadership principles are demonstrated. The first is this really amazing, thriving community of practitioners that have come together as part of the Diversity and Inclusion Network. It's called DIGNA, and you can find it on Facebook. So this community really has worked to find new ways, new tools, new strategies to make social inclusion an integral part of civil society organizations. And I think it's really managed to push the narrative about embracing social inclusion, embracing diversity as a fundamental part of being relevant to the challenges of the world today. So the work that they've done in connecting and amplifying conversations, for instance, on dealing with gender-based violence or the issues being faced by people with disabilities or gay communities in the context of the COVID-19 crisis are a really good example of how we can do a better job of intergenerational learning and collaboration on some of these really deep-rooted issues. A second example would be the Social Security Protocol for Civil Society that 200 organizations have adopted during the COVID-19 crisis. For me, this is a real representation that feminist leadership principles are essentially about making rights real. So they're not about short-term superficial solutions, but really about long-term entitlements that allow people to claim their rights fully and transparently. So the Social Security Protocol really provides an opportunity for organizations to be explicit, to have a genuinely authentic dialogue with co-workers on how the organization is not just supporting their transition into a digital or an online working space or a kind of a COVID-19 context, but more so, have that conversation about how we're guaranteeing social protection measures and how we're doing our best to secure jobs and incomes in the context of the economic uncertainties of the COVID-19 pandemic. So I invite you to respond to this message with your own feedback and maybe your own experiences of how you're experiencing feminist leadership principles. We'd love to know more about what we can do better and more of to increase our own impact around this area of how our work is experienced. So please feel free to use this website to provide your feedback and comments. You can also look out for us on Twitter. We're at Civicus Alliance. And we'd love to keep this conversation going. Thank you.